seemingly a little bit uncomfortable.
The thing is, it's so hard to attack jungle when Vengi also has a really strong performance on Nunu, and you kind of have to cover both those bases while also banning the Kalista. There's no way that Steelback can go up against Bang's Kalista. We saw what Def did when he got that champion versus Steelback.
Very interesting bans coming in so far. Lulu, Azir, and Cassiopeia already taken out, as well as getting Yellowstar off that Nautilus. Yellowstar did a fantastic job of locking down Bang in their last game, and it really prolonged that game by quite a long time.
No focus on the junglers just yet. Gragas, Sejuani, Rek'Sai all up there. Rek'Sai still 100% picked or banned at the mid-season Invitational. Urgot taken off the table. We've seen Steelback running it. Last ban from Fnatic.
LeBlanc or Kalista's coming.
It has to be. So will SKT go with the LeBlanc? I feel like they have to take it away because Vividin will take it then in the next round.
Going to first pick the Rek'Sai, however.
We'll have to see whether or not Vividin does prioritize that LeBlanc, and more importantly, whether it can work against Faker.
They've already targeted Faker with two bans. I don't see why they would not pick the mid lane champion here. And giving away not only the Rek'Sai, but also the LeBlanc to SKT is just so much mid game power.
So Rek'Sai, so far for SK Telecom, has really worked. Bengi is professionally undefeated on Rek'Sai so far.
No pressure for Fnatic then. Let's also take stock of the fact that all of the top laners, maybe we can ignore Cassio, for Huni, are still available. So the likes of your Hecarim, the likes of your Rumble.
True.
We'll see what Huni and Marin decide to prioritize, and very importantly, when they decide to lock those picks in.
I feel like they can wait on the top lane right now, since it hasn't been focused at all in bans. There's so many options open. Wow, he's going to blind pick the Sivir here. The Kalista and Urgot are already banned out. So this is definitely something that's strong for Fnatic, is having Steelbuck on the more teamfight-oriented carry, being able to use that Sivir speed for the quick movements in the mid-game map control. That's where they attacked SKT last time. That's where AHQ attacked them, trying to make those quick movements early on.
I'm very interested, though, because the laning phase did go quite poorly last time as well, and Bang did pick the Lucian into the Sivir, was up 25 CS at 10 minutes, and they pretty much had to abandon Steelback to farm at his tier 2 turret after it was destroyed and make plays on the top side of the map with Yellowstar.
We'll have to see what Yellowstar decides to play if this Thresh gets locked in. Yellowstar's only other champion he's played this tournament was the Annie, and it left much to be desired. We'll see what Yellowstar prioritizes. The Corki Thresh lane for SKT, leaving both of their solo lanes to the last round.
So I'm still going to be on the fence about this Corki. Maybe they flex it, but I don't see why they would go away from the Lucian for Bank, since it's been such a strong pick for him.
I don't think they're going to play Corki in the mid lane. That has never happened in Korea, so I would be quite surprised. But you never know what Faker's going to do. But they're so good. SK Telecom has been very good about hitting Corki power spikes with that Trinity Force and taking down early turrets. So just about that 15-minute timing.
And that's something that Fnatic have struggled somewhat with in the past, knowing when to actually pick those fights. They tend to just go all in all the time, and it does not always work. A slow pick and ban phase here as both teams taking their time. The pick of the litter for junglers as far as Reignover is concerned, we were discussing either Gragas or Sejuani.
Yeah, definitely going to be the Gragas. If you want to try and keep up with Rek'Sai in the early game, you pretty much cannot go with a Sejuani. Her early game falls behind Rek'Sai substantially.
We do see the Alistar support for Yellowstar. So Huni leaving top lane to counterpick the player with the highest team percentage damage for Fnatic. And we'll see whether or not Huni can carry Fnatic once we get into the game. Last round of picks for SKT, where are they going?
It's a little bit interesting so far, because is SKT going to go for a more siege-oriented composition? Are they going to play for a more high damage late game mid laner as well? There's still that possibility coming in, but it's going to be Ezreal for Faker.
One thing I want to highlight, when Fnatic lost games in the final in Madrid in the European LCS, it was against range poke from Unicorns of Love. Fnatic really struggled to deal with that.
And actually, this is a composition that SK Telecom ran a lot very early in this season. Since then, some of the kiting comps have fallen away as more hard CC and crowd control has entered the game a little bit. But Faker is really a wonderful mid-Ezreal player, and we've seen him just get some pretty spectacular solo kills. And he also has an incredible presence on the map with True Shot Barrage. What he will do is he will constantly fire it into top and bottom lane just to chunk out the enemy laners and help his teammates in terms of the laning phase.
I am very curious if we're looking at a lane swap situation here, too. Whoa! It's going to be the Hecarim, of course.
So we will be seeing Yellowstar for the first time on Alistar. We will be seeing our first Ezreal of the tournament in the semifinals. Huni on a champion he is rarely allowed to get in Europe, but it has yet to provide fantastic results here at MSI.
And Marin as well, 13-1 all time in his career on Maokai. It's been one of his go-to champions, particularly this season, and he's just been dominant on it in terms of team fighting.
The other thing that I always like to point out about Marin is that his affinity for buying those early home guard boots. Now, Maokai is the one top laner that I haven't seen him do it that often on. He does it on Rumble, he does it on Gnar, he does it on Hecarim. I'm a little bit sad that he's not on one of these champions, but he should be able to contain that lane.
And just talking about the Hecarim, Huni preferring the Smite teleport as opposed, Ignite teleport as opposed to the Smite teleport. We'll see whether or not Huni can get aggressive enough in lane. Team comps locked in for the first match of this best of five. And both teams will be swapping blue side, red side throughout the series.
I actually am kind of excited for Fnatic early on here. Before the Trinity Force get completed, if they can make some of those early moves, the early teleport from Huni coming in, and the speed boost here from Steelback, they might be able to try and make another strong early run at SKT.
Well, we'll see if they can make it work. You guys at home and in the crowd, you know what to do. Hit us up on Twitter at LOL Esports. Use that hashtag SKT win or FNC win. Let's tear the roof off the house as we load up onto the Rift. For the first time in the semifinals, Korea versus Europe. Fnatic needing to improve upon their performance from yesterday. And they've got all the tools they need to make it happen.
I'm really interested that SK Telecom picked this composition after it's been so long since we last saw them play it. It's a really comfort comp for them. And I think they're just trying not to show their hand early on in the series, see if they can take a win with something that they haven't really had to practice, something that they're not going to have to reveal too much about what their picks are going to be, especially if they go through into the finals.
And there's something I do like about the mid lane Ezreal. Europe flirted with it a little bit during the middle of the spring split, but primarily the style of fight, peel, land, poke, and then secure objectives. Fnatic really struggled with it. Power of Evil played a mid lane Varus, completely catching Fnatic off guard and securing objectives.
It also makes sense, too, that they would ban the Nautilus in this composition and then early pick the Thresh so that they eliminate some of the ability to make picks. Yes, there's still the Alistar Headbutt combo, but it's a little bit less reliable. And they have the Sivir, so some decent engage here, but it's going to come down to Huni's teleports, I think, pretty clearly. That's kind of what Fnatic lives and dies by. So as long as SKT plays more conservatively early, watches out for some of these roams, I think that they'll be quite able just to farm up into the power spike.
Well, we do see Yellowstar a little bit of pressure. Febiven got that early ward into Brambleback camp. Fnatic decide to peel away. Relatively shallow wards across the map. Both teams playing quite safe, and it doesn't look like we're going to get that lane swap as Huni is starting on that Wolf camp.
Yeah, it looks like we will take Gromp for Fnatic right here, so they will have that XP advantage going into lane. Didn't really help them last time they were in this matchup, however, as we did see the lane get chunked out pretty severely early on.
Bang and Wolf already in lane. Gonna get their way closer to that level 2 power spike. Let's see what Steelback and Yellowstar can do. Steelback really, really struggling during the laning phase of this tournament. But
yeah,
it did show in the mid to late team fights against SKT yesterday, it was significantly improved.
To try and help him out, Yellowstar has also started the heal first on Alistar to heal back up from the Gromp. And they're going to try their best to CS under the turret here as they've given up the early shove to SKT. They do have the extra experience, though, once the waves do even out.
We did just catch a quick glimpse there of Huni in the top lane. Remember, no flash or teleport, so Bengi potentially with an easier route to securing kills for SKT. We'll see if he decides to prioritize that lane. As it stands, bottom lane pushing against Fnatic, and top lane appears to be for the time being.
And Faker really respecting the early gank moves possible with the Gragas here, playing very far back with Ezreal. Going to be really difficult to make anything happen for Reignover in that mid lane.
Yeah, Reignover a bit low right here compared to Bengi, though. He does have to be a bit careful. Could have a bit of a scuffle over the Scuttle Crab right here. Marn actually getting quite low on the top side.
Oh, there's an Ignite for Huni, but not a lot of mana. Forces the flash.
Wow, forces
it a threat
without even using the Ignite as well. That is absolutely huge.
Plus, Huni can keep this wave right where he wants it. There's an extra range minion there, so he can just hold that wave in his territory and make Marn overextend once again. They have to expect, since they just saw both junglers in the top side, though, that there will be continued jungle pressure here. Reignover better move over quick.
We'll see if he does. Does make it up to the tower. Summoner spell available. Huni's got some mana back. Bengi attempting to counter, I believe. We'll see if he decides to come in. Here comes the gank. Reignover's available. This is a 2v2. Huni's in trouble. That's a flash from Reignover. First blood secured by Huni. And they turn their attention to Bengi, but it's not enough. And Fnatic are on the board.
You have to see that one coming.
Yeah,
Bengi,
absolutely.
Are you kidding me? Bengi, you just chased him out of the Dragon Pit. You know your top laner is down flash. Plus, he's up against the Hecarim, who has the advantage with Ignite. Yeah. That is just insane to go for that.
Yeah, there's no way you win that 2v2. At the best, Bengi should have been there waiting to see and maybe disengage a little bit. But you certainly do not go in. Terrible gank.
Well, SKT immediately on the back foot. Fnatic, small advantage. Ninja Tabby picked up for Huni, as well as the Skirmisher Saber for Reignover. He did train to go the Cinder Hulk on Gragas, but he prioritized the Warrior when he was on Rek'Sai for those aggressive ganks. Febiven does distortion in, goes backwards. That's a flash forward from Bengi. Febiven responds in kind. Faker rooted in place, unable to follow.
Faker should be recalling for his tier at about this time, so it looks like he will go back and already with a CS advantage in this lane by just a little bit, but there's going to be a lot picked up on that turret at the same time. Reignover already invading in the jungle. Bengi has to back off.
We really have to look down the road as well. The ramifications of that move up top are going to be tremendous. The first blood went on to Huni. He's got the early boots. He can upgrade to his home guards early. Uh-oh.
Oh, Yellow Star, are you doing it again? He's played backwards. Bengi gets pulled in. Yellow Star's knocked up. Summoner heal used by Steelback, and he's on the retreat. Pulverize comes out, and Yellow Star, in the wrong position, gives up the first kill to SKT.
Yeah, Marin still having a hell of a hard time here in the top side. Huni, interesting that he got the Ninja Tabby as well. It's first item, not really going to help out. He must be very confident about how this lane is going to go, because that gold isn't particularly useful to him, at least in the 1v1.
Yeah, I guess here. Also, he won't have, you know, any sort of reduction on if he gets hooked, I guess. That would be really the only issue.
Double AD comp, gentlemen. He's buying for the mid game and the
yeah.
late game.
Huni's a guy that wants to take over the entire game, not just the lane.
And he always teleports to help out his duo lane, so we'll see if that helps him out. Anyways, Marin may be in trouble. Reignover's coming in, level 5. True Shot Barrage flying in from the mid lane. Onslaught of Shadows coming in a little bit of trouble, looking for the last hit. They do manage to tag team, and Reignover goes down to the minions. Assist to Faker, they tried.
And that is what you have to worry about when Faker plays Ezreal in mid lane. He is incredibly accurate with True Shot Barrage coming out of mid. And he will constantly shoot it. Every time the cooldown is up, he'll push a wave with it. He'll try and chunk out the duo lane and bottom. So he has so much presence on this champion, it's absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, I actually really like it for Faker. Because people constantly send multiple champions mid, Ezreal, you can be so safe and just farm while you have your tier and contribute across the map. Really good first draft phase here for SKT.
7 minutes on the clock, and we see Yellow Star with an early roam to the mid lane. No boots yet. Something that Yellow Star does like to do whenever steal back and just wave clear on that Sivir, but manages to dissuade any roams of Wolf himself.
The home guards have been completed here for Huni off of that back, and he has a few seconds of teleport discrepancy here between him and Marin. But that should come up very quickly.
Yeah, and also his dual lane isn't there to take advantage of it right at the moment. So time they hit the lane again, they may be back in.
And yeah, and the other thing is that the duo lane, if you have a weak duo lane like that, it's very hard for you to get ward control, to get deep wards to teleport in on the first place. Because SKT have such a strong duo, and they got that kill on Yellowstar, you know, moving up too far to get the wards, they can easily keep those brushes clean constantly down on the bottom side and deny Huni the teleport.
I will say I'm a bit confused by this Maokai pick coming in, even though Marin has been traditionally fantastic on this champion. Just taking the Gnar away here for a more aggressive lane, I think, would have been a lot better and still provide a lot of peel for the double AD carries if necessary. Because it seems to me coming in, if you have to be worried about Huni's presence on the map, so make it as hard for him as possible to make plays.
Wow. Yeah.
Huni's trading with Marin. Also, one thing to touch on, this is quite reminiscent of yesterday's game. Fairly slow laning phase with SKT just getting marginal wins across the majority of the map. It's only Huni that's doing well in the top lane.
But just like yesterday, we're now seeing a huge CS differential open up between Bang and Steelback. It was 25 at 10 minutes. It's already pretty close to 30 at the moment. And that's going to be pretty problematic. And I will say, most of the time in Korea, Faker.
Wow, it even happens to Faker? That's personal. And farming.
His true shot barrage is insane.
I don't know if that one was insane.
Hey,
that was all right.
It's a double whammy.
It was a double whammy.
Okay.
Got a double down.
Well, to go back, well, never mind. We'll wait for this.
Bang all does right. get the lantern. Now, flashes back and gets to safety. Kobe, what would you like to say?
I want to go back and touch on Mani's point about the Maokai over Gnar in the top lane. Uh-oh, good exchange here for Febiven. But
here
Faker able to dodge.
Bangy! He's managed to knock up Febiven. Febiven gets Munch as a double teleport to the top lane. Huni has jumped forward. Faker's being ignited. The barrier's now up. Here comes Reynover. He gets a double barrel body slam. Marin on the back line as it's a 3v4. Faker continuing to spam out Mystic Shot after Mystic Shot. Faker's on the board. Faker, playmaker. Manages to get the flay onto Yellowstar. Now he's in trouble. You can't milk those horns as he flashes back. We do see the box going down as some range damage lands from SKT. Fnatic trade 0-2 in that fight. And Faker throws out the true shot.
Insane! No, but they're gonna take up this dragon, but that just illustrates the point I was about to bring up about Maokai versus Gnar. The main thing that Maokai does have over Gnar is on-demand teleport impact. He's very, very consistent. Gnar, you kind of have to work around the rage bar, and when you're facing a team that has Hecarim and Sivir, you don't always have the choice of waiting around that and being able to work around it. So maybe they were respecting Fnatic's ability to pull the trigger very quickly, and they just want a more responsive top laner. It definitely worked out there for him in the mid lane, and that's going to be a huge, huge lead here for SKT, already on the board with their first dragon.
And we take a look at this too. So Faker going to land the Mystic Shot right at first and then shift over to the side. Bengi already here isn't fooled by the fake LeBlanc walking into the river. And by this time, of course, Huni comes in, but Faker has barrier, so really difficult. Huni does get baited in a little bit. And then the rest of the fight, Faker's able to just shoot in more Mystic Shots from the periphery while they wrap up multiple members of Fnatic.
Outplayed team fight indeed for SKT. They secure themselves a 1,000 gold lead. Reignover is hooked. Death sentence is landed. You are sentenced to death, son. SKT chasing. Oh, I spoke too soon. Explosive cast knocks them back. And the Fat Man gets away.
The exchanges from Faker already really, really finding their mark on Febiven. He's been able to upgrade very quickly. Now he'll get working towards his Muramana even faster, counting auto attacks as well. Plus, we do have to give a shout out to Bengi because after the first really poor choice for the gank, he's made up for it very quickly. He's kept up his map presence. And Huni doing some work on Marin, but not able to bait him in.
Well, this time around, Reignover forced to use that explosive cast defensively. Not available aggressively. Bengi's going to tremor sense his opposite number through the river. And SKT, a successful roam to the mid lane. There will be a lot of damage. They're probably going to take this one to 280 carries. And very risky wave clear if Febiven wants to go in.
Well, taking this mid turret is absolutely huge for these poke compositions as well. They can open up so much of the map. And, as we see Bengi going in, actually.
Oh, Wolf manages to connect to the death sentence, trying to make it two. The flash, the body slam. Bengi follows through with a flash of his own. Lantern's available and gets out. Reignover refuses to go down.
He keeps on making all of these escapes, and they're really well-played escapes, but he's getting caught in the first place. And it's costing him a lot of cooldowns. No ultimate, no flash available. Ultimate will come up soon.
I want to touch on Marin's Maokai build a little bit, because I'm not sure a lot of people know what he does and a lot of the Korean and Chinese Maokais. What he does is he builds Catalyst into Shroud or Cowl, and then builds either Shroud or Cowl after that, as we see Fnatic coming in on Bang.
And Bang's going to Valk away. Steelback looking for more. Huni, do you want to dive? Summon a heal, use Bang trying to dodge. Fear throws him against the wall, but Steelback doesn't connect to the Boomerang. Turret aggro will be on Huni, and that is a kill on the board. No one from SKT to reply, but they do get their third of the game.
Plus, with the home guards, Huni can just base and run back to lane really quickly here. Shouldn't have lost anything up top. So, very good use of time there for Huni. Able to get something for that bottom lane.
And I think important to note, Steelback only down 12 CS at 14 minutes. That roam from SKT may be costing Bang some CS.
They did get the mid tower, though.
Touché.
So.
Fair point.
The goal he did get.
Full steal back
goal.
And CSing. This is impressive. I know that's quite harsh, but he's struggled in his five prior games. And Fnatic have given him a kill as well, thanks to that roam from Huni. And now they're fighting over this red buff, Cody. No, they're not. I was waiting for the fight. I'm like, come on, go in.
Bebevin heard you. Baker.
So, what I want to touch on that Maokai build as well, since I didn't get a chance to finish explaining it, is that it's more well-rounded. Yes, you don't complete a big core item immediately, but it makes it so when you TP in the mid-game teamfights, you can deal with all the types of damage that are coming your way very efficiently. So, it's really all about powering up for the mid-game before you complete, like, a Frozen Heart or Spirit Visage or anything like that.
I definitely agree. And on top of that, you don't really need to rush into the Righteous Glory with this team. Most of his teleports right now are going to be those defensive teleports that we saw, like, mid, where Fnatic are the ones trying to get the initiation on the double AD, and he's going to be more of a peeling Maokai.
Tag, you're it. Faker does connect down bottom, but the minion wave cleared out by Steelback.
Oh. Bang, you got that blue buff.
He's just borrowing it.
So you're saying he's planning on dying soon and then transferring it over to Faker.
It's not, but I'll go with that. I can get on board this theory.
Complex blue buff strategies.
Uh-huh.
Korean blue buff strategies, if you will, Monte Cristo. Faker, 131 CS, very close to Febivin. Every time we look at this mid lane, Febivin's trying to poke Faker out, but it's not really garnering a lot. Bengi with the blue buff and the cooldowns. Can he get in? Huni is going to gallop to safety.
And Marin's actually quietly taken a CS lead after being behind in this lane as well. After he got some items, Huni wasn't able to bully him that much anymore. And I do think that part of this is Huni's itemization here, because he hasn't built to actually deal with Marin's Maokai magic damage. So the trades have been pretty favorable as time has gone on.
Yeah, building for the cross map plays, trying to get a little bit of armor in so that he can build the Trinity Force first without having to sidetrack himself. And get cloth armor on the side. We'll see, though. Next dragon coming up in 22 seconds, and both teleports will be ready for this one.
And Faker gets the red buff since he didn't get the blue buff. Bengi felt bad, so he donated him something else instead.
Manages to make at least that play work. SKT still hold on to that 1,000 gold lead. It's around 1,200 at this stage in time. You see the Cowl picked up there for Bengi. Some more tank stats for Marin. And Trinity Force Spike's getting closer and closer, and we'll see whether or not that's going to give SKT the power they need.
Yep, Fnatic already prepping for the second dragon here. Bottom turret down, deep wards inside the jungle, and they already started it, actually. Prep completed.
Wow, that's not a lot of contest yet. Teleports available for both Marin and Huni. Here come SKT. Teleport into the pit. It is earlier than Huni's. Huni has not channeled yet.
He's
not getting. Dragon secured for Fnatic, and it looks like they're on the retreat.
He's getting home guard.
Grab control.
Canceled
Huni
his bait.
Canceled it.
Yeah, just staying there right now. Fnatic intelligently just pulling out of that fight, but SK Telecom really not there with any setup whatsoever, and now they have TP advantage, which is huge for this Fnatic team.
Plus, they already committed to shoving down the mid turret here, so even though Fnatic are all spread out, they would have to shove really deep into Fnatic territory to get another objective, and Huni gets to push the lane all the way up to the top turret.
And I think we have to touch on the fact that that was a smart dragon play from Fnatic. They rushed it down, they had Crab, and they got out clean.
And it's just after they had taken out the bottom tier turret too, so that's going to be very effective. I'm actually surprised that SK Telecom didn't commit more. There's a TP.
Just kidding.
We do see it. Hooney is going to onslaught over. Flay backwards from Wolf. Is it enough? Ignite is ticking away. Hooney takes through the wall. Does continue to throw out those rampages. Here comes Febiv, and Febiv is chunked down from where was, I believe, a True Shot Barrage. Using the clone to scout out, and Fnatic on the retreat. So the teleport advantage nullified for the flash of Wolf.
Maokai probably should get this top turret then. And because that teleport didn't gain them anything, that's a pretty big win for SKT. Good disengage there with the Thresh.
And the flash on Thresh also not going to be too consequential, because the thing about SKT's composition is that having that flash on the support, Thresh is primarily here to create picks if he can, and also to disengage.
Well, Bingy's going to be able to basically call chicken to Fnatic and just waltz his way out. Reignova opted not to use that explosive cask. Shiver is quite available. Cooldown as they clear out those tunnels, and now Fnatic find themselves 2,000 gold down. They do have that very important dragon on their side. And Hooney gets caught out, takes a full combo from Marin, a little pony pet.
Marin, though,
space, and look at the trade difference.
Yeah, that build that you talked about, while Hooney has not built at all for the lane with no magic resist, so much armor and health here for Marin. He easily can take every trade right now.
So we're getting very close to where SK Telecom is probably going to be at their biggest item power spike in this game. As soon as Faker picks up the Trinity Force, we see them collapsing around blue.
And they should be able to get this one. Fnatic in retreat. That's a flash from Bang, Reignova rather, as Bang was trying to get the Flay down. So blue buff secured by SKT, forcing Fnatic out of their own jungle, losing those outer turrets, now costing them presence in their own jungle.
And this is a composition that you really don't want to give up your blue buff to SK Telecom, because if they get a blue on Ezreal and on Corki, it's some absolutely crazy poke.
Well, we did see Marin forced to flash into the Baron Pit, but Febiven did not connect with those chains anyway. A little bit of an over-aggressive move. I imagine Faker must be very close to that Trinity Force. Two components completed. And every time we see him chunking out Febiven, that's a lot of damage.
Yeah, I really feel like Fnatic are gonna need to consolidate fairly soon here, because they don't have the teleport from Hooney. Uh-oh.
Oh, he missed the chains again. Faker saves a Mystic Shot. He is gonna throw True Shot Barrage and picks the clone.
Oh.
Febiven goes in. Faker flashes away from the distortion, and that is a very confident 1v1 from Febiven.
Double flashes right there. Febiven flashed to even get that opportunity. So even trade there from the mid laners, really good give and take.
That's not something I was expecting from Febiven. He's not really shone this tournament quite as much as he does in the European LCS. But his LeBlanc is seemingly more comfortable for him. He's challenging Faker, despite needing to get past all that range of Ezreal.
Well, as Mighty said, this transformation into Muramana is about to come through with the completed Trinity Force almost at the same time. There it is right now for Faker, so you won't be able to get away with those trades for much longer.
Yeah, this is where it really gets crazy. But the Outer Ring of Turrets already down, so SKT really needs to aggressively advance their ward line at the moment and see if they can get this next dragon and then transition it into some siege.
Fnatic have to be very decisive in the next few minutes. They cannot afford to get poked down by an Ezreal with fully transformed Muramana and the Corki.
And not only that, yeah, I mean, he's just hugely up there in terms of his cooldown reduction as well. So the next blue buff should be very important for Faker to pick up also.
Well, Trinity Forces across the board. Hooney, Faker, Bang, all completed. At about 20 minutes yesterday, SKT and Fnatic started eventual bloodbath that would result in a Fnatic loss. We'll see if Fnatic can find team fights, because they're just being strangled out of the game. They've lost control of their jungle. They're now 3,000 gold down, and SKT just keep inching their way forward.
Yeah, this is a great time for them to shove, because without the teleport home guard flank from Hooney, it's so difficult for Fnatic to try and wave clear this, even though they have Sivir and Gragas on duty.
And look how much damage they got on the turret right there, just in that single wave. With the double sheens, they're going to be able to push it out really quickly, and the timing couldn't be better, because Fnatic has to defend. They're going to get hit by some of these skill shots, and then they're not going to be able to fight the dragon, so great timing.
While they do find Wolf, he's been knocked up. Hooney hops over the wall. That's Wolf down. Now they turn to Bengi. Bang is in retreat. Faker coming from the mid lane. Bengi gets hopped on by Hooney. Chilling Smite is out. We do see the auto attack from Steel.
Oh.
With the True Shot Barrage, hits four. Now Bang and Faker with Marin trying to shred them down. Reignova's in retreat. Hooney's low. That's a knock-up on Faker, and Yellowstar knocks him into the waiting hands of Febiven. Febiven unable to close it out, but that's a double for Bang. That's a triple for Bang, and a two for three turnaround as SKT pile it on Fnatic.
Great re-engage there from SKT to have the confidence, even after two members get picked off and five members of Fnatic standing, with no cooldowns and no resources left to pick up those kills.
It's also just a testament to the power spike that we're seeing right now comparatively. Forbidden in the brush looking for a pick.
Can he get it?
Stay there. Don't do it. There you go. Don't go for that. You're not 100%ing either Marn or Bang.
Points for effort, though.
Yeah.
Ops into the safe play, and that means SKT will get Dragon number two, and that lead continues to grow.
And one thing about this tournament that's very interesting in general is that, yes, of course, Dragon's always been an important objective, but particularly at this one, the team's really going for that as we take a look at this play.
So this is the decisive move that I was actually talking about right now for Fnatic, and they get the early quick kill, and they have Bang low, but the choice comes after they pick up Bang here to try and split and run. What they should do is make the call to sacrifice one for the greater good of the herd. Yet, they decide to make a split move here, re-engage, Steelback sticks around also. You notice that they do have the Crab Speed Shrine as well, so they very well could have made that choice to sacrifice one.
And SK Telecom made a mistake right there. They should not have been in that top side of the jungle, given the fact that the Dragon was about to come up. And Fnatic did a good job of taking advantage of it. But just don't get greedy. Take what you can get during that power spike. Turn it into that Dragon.
Exactly. Their power comes from setting up the battle lines with the double AD, trying to stay behind the Maokai and Rek'Sai.
Didn't work out that time round, but a re-engage, as you highlighted, Kobe, going in SKT's favor. Bang, got that Blade of the Rune King completed. Faker picked himself up a Vamp Scepter. Let's go along with that Trinity Force and completed Mura Mana.
Yeah, he's going to be probably going Bloodthirster as his next item, just for some additional shield. And the lifesteal he's going to get, the two shields with his barrier, he's going to become extremely difficult to kill.
He already is extremely difficult to kill.
He does have that reputation.
Fnatic are quickly running out of options, as they are now being denied all of their buffs multiple times in a row. Let's see, here's the fight. Huni's in trouble. The red buff will get secured by Reynov. He smites it, and Huni gets out. But SKT stamping their authority in the top half of the map.
Fnatic do have a small window here. Even though they are behind, the key summoner spells for Bang are both down, and Faker doesn't have barrier for a little bit longer while the teleport. Uh-oh.
Oh, Yellowstone, a little bit of a wrong position. He does get caught by the death sentence, flayed backwards. The box is down. We see Yellowstone knocking Wolf into the back line, but he manages to flash over the wall.
Teleport going in for Huni.
Here comes Marin. Marin lands onto Reignover. Faker's trying to find a kill onto Grack.
There he is!
Now Huni's found Faker! Faker's down! It's a first death! Now Huni onslaughts onto Bengi. Bang's in trouble. Yellowstar looking for the knocker. He only found the underground critter. Bang is managing to survive. Finds the ledge of the safety. Wolf re-engages. That's a spell shield. Steelback saves himself. Huni's now going to be the next victim. But the boomerang blade kills the man that started it all. Wolf is down. It's not over as Marin and Bengi want more. They found Steelback. They're looking for Yellowstar, and it's steak for dinner as SKT ace the European team.
And that should be the inhibitor turret as well. Perfect timing with the minion wave. SKT were already pushing up mid.
Yeah, and right there, it's interesting. Marin actually going for the frozen heart, so not having that many resistances to deal with this LeBlanc, but it's not really their concern. He actually managed to flash back over that wall, get back into the fight, and help turn it around, even though he did get zoned out pretty early on.
All right, so let's take another look. This was without barrier, without the flash and heal on Bang either. So it gets started on Yellowstar. Alistar, thankfully, with that ultimate, able to take a lot of abuse here. Now, Huni, he had to teleport very far back to a ward that's out of vision of SKT. Comes in and takes down Faker at the very beginning of this, but Marin is doing a lot of work on the backside too, picks up Gragas, and then some really good peeling by that tank line, making up for the lack of summoner spells of SKT and buying that time. Even though it goes down to the ignite, Marin's still at full health, and Rek'Sai is healing from her passive, does so much in this extremely long team fight.
And also, Marin, since he has that Frozen Heart completed, perfectly able to tank the inhibitor turret right there, no problem at all. Can't quite take down the tower itself, however.
Well, the inhibitor turrets penetrate almost 80% of your armor. It's really what you want is stacking health to take those.
Well, we do see Fnatic playing aggressively around the Baron Pit, trying not to lose control of the Crab, but they do in the end. I think that was Bengi smiting it out. Vision and a Shrine available to them, and Fnatic forced to back off. Still 6k gold down, 4 kills down, 3 towers down. Fnatic did okay in the laning phase. But now they are falling further and further behind. Steelback still yet to pick up an armor pin item. And he's going to need that if he wants to try cut through Mara Nobengi.
SK Telecom starting to look at this Baron right now. They need to set up for the Dragon coming in first. See if they can get number 3. But Fnatic, they don't want to be sneaky around this Baron at all. And if they can get some poke, they may be able to do something right here.
Rainover's eaten a lot of death sentences this game. Bevavent with no distortion available. We hear Rek'Sai coming in. Rainover caught once more. Hooney's looking for a target. Does have Onslaught available, but not enough times. He does find Dap on the back line. That's Hooney and Yellowstone are trying to get Wolf. They've lost their top lane. And Fnatic trying to do what they can. They've lost another damage dealer in Bevavent. Steelback's in full retreat, as that's not going to be enough. 4 members down as SKT smashed through Fnatic. And that was Fnatic getting caught out once more.
And Faker's target selection during that fight was pretty crucial to that victory, because he immediately swapped onto Fabivin as soon as Fabivin entered the fray and killed him almost immediately.
Seeing one of the reasons why the Assassins fell off in the Cinder Hulk meta. There are a bunch of tanks in this game. It's so difficult for Fabivin to get around them to actually get meaningful damage on a squishy target. He uses the combo forward on one of the tanks, the primary tank here, and then he doesn't get to add much DPS at all to this team fight. Meanwhile, Faker on the AD carry, constantly adding damage, whereas Fabivin struggling here to do much.
Yeah, tries to go straight through the fight right there, and Faker's just waiting for him to come back.
It's annihilated.
To his original starting point right there, and picks up the kill after getting a few autos in.
Baron and Dragon number 3 for SKT. Almost 10,000 gold as we about to tick over 30 minutes on the clock. Fnatic, the game is now almost out of their hands. Barring a misposition from SKT, don't see Fnatic pulling themselves back in here. They will take solace in their second tower, though. And that will slowly close that goal gap. Bengi, though, he wants to fight. He's got Baron buff, and Hooney's just going to be in full retreat. There's no support either member yet, and Hooney, I think, wise to move himself out of the lane.
And this is where SKT really shines. The fact that they got the Baron buff with this poke composition means that this siege is so incredibly hard to deal with. Fnatic has to look for a hard engage. Fortunately for them, the teleport will be back up soon, so they can see if they can find something, but it's going to be pretty difficult.
So difficult because they have no map control. Really hard to sneak wards into a good spot here.
Relying on those teleports from Hooney, much more difficult without wards, Kobe. Bengi pushing top, the rest of SKT pushing both middle and bottom. There are 2 outer turrets remaining, and a lot of damage on that mid lane inhibitor turret.
SKT just pretty methodically going from lane to lane, making sure all the waves go up, and they'll just keep moving around until they find that point of weakness. Fnatic not going to be really able to defend this tower. They already have a position behind it, so that'll be another tier 2. Going to SKT.
For a team like Fnatic, I think they have to take some solace in the fact that they did hold even for at least the 10 to 15 minutes, but it wasn't enough. And their thoughts must now be on the next game. How do they adjust? It will be a Fnatic blue side match, unless some miracle can occur for them to pull themselves back in. I'm using Gragas and Sivir to wave clear, but that's a long range Baron empowered siege minion.
Yeah, and then Faker can just walk up and face tank these two, considering that he has the Bloodthirster, makes it even harder. It'll grab Yellowstar, though.
So much damage being connected from the Muramana. Tower will fall as Bang and Wolf will take it out. That's the engage. Rainover's in trouble. He's down. SKT now knocking onto the Nexus, or rather the top lane inhibitor. That's 4 members stacked up high. True Shot Barrage thrown across, and Fnatic, they have to somehow fight without their primary tank. Hooney's got Onslaught available, and I don't think it's going to be enough. Nexus turret now is going to fall. The double AD carries plus Trinity Force shredding through the Nexus of Fnatic. That's a 4-man knockup, but Fabivin eats a death sentence. Wolf has removed one of the damage dealers. The Assassin is forced to retreat. Steelback trying to get through. Does have that Last Whisper, but he's got too many targets. Hooney is now down, and SKT waiting for the minions to pour onto the next Nexus turret.
Not wasting any time here. This looks like they want to end the game very quickly. And SKT start this best of five off on the right foot.
Another kill going to Bang. Death sentence on a Steelback. Wolf has been impeccable this game. And at 32 and a half minutes, SK Telecom will knock the first nail into Fnatic's coffin.
I really like what SKT did in terms of their adaptations. They took away some of these champions that gave them a hard time, particularly I think that Nautilus, because Yellowstar really didn't have the same impact as he did in their first game. He couldn't lock down Bang as efficiently, and so the Thresh pick early, the Nautilus ban doing a lot of work here, I think, and denying one of the Fnatic's best players the ability to make plays.
Interesting to see the whole team of SKT still sitting discussing the game very intently. Looking at what went right, what went wrong. For Fnatic, I think a little bit of pride in their laning phase. They were not completely outclassed. They were against a team comp that needed time, let's be honest, as well. But they do need to take some of the positives away and try and inject that into the next game of the series.
Yeah, I'm really curious what Vivian will do in the next game, because we were looking at the picks earlier, and he's played LeBlanc, Zed, and Cassiopeia only, the only champions he's played here at MSI. He doesn't really play the Azir. So if they even sub in...
Interesting, what? He doesn't play, hasn't played it yet, but it has been banned twice, which is something that we're not used to. We've not seen him play at an EU.
Right. Could be a Huni pick. You know, he's already played Cassiopeia top.
Could be something that was happening in scrims here. There may be some other information, obviously, that the players have that we do not. But I'm looking forward to the next ban phase in particular, because Fnatic, I think they were playing with fire a little bit there, not banning out the LeBlanc against SK Telecom. That generally doesn't go too well for
people.
That's
the thing.
And they can't do it. So they certainly can't do that on blue side. So
we did see the Rek'Sai high priority again. First pick for SKT. It is a high priority pick for Fnatic. You have to feel that will be one of the more contested picks. Now the Fnatic at blue side. Do SKT feel strongly enough to ban it away from Reignover?
Plus, I am very curious to hear if SKT have decided to sub in EasyHoon or not.
That is a great point.
It changes things tremendously, especially being on red side.
We will